Hello everyone. I hope that the first few days of term have gone off well and we're ready to take on all that lies ahead. Today, for the chapel service, I'd like to do a reading about the Emmaus Road Surprise, and it comes from St. Luke's Gospel, chapter 24, reading from verse 13. That same day, two of them were walking to the village Emmaus, about 7 miles out of Jerusalem. They were deep in conversation, going over all the things that had happened. In the middle of their talk and questions, Jesus came up and walked alongside them, but they were not able to recognize who he was. He asked, "What's this you're discussing so intently as you walk along?" They just stood there, long-faced, like they'd lost their best friend. Then one of them, his name was Cleopas, said, "Are you the only one in Jerusalem who hasn't heard what's happened during the last few days?" He said, "What has happened?" They said, "The things that happened to Jesus the Nazarene. He was a man of God, a prophet, dynamic in work and word, blessed by both God and all the people. Then our high priests and leaders betrayed him, got him sentenced to death and crucified him. And we had our hopes up that he was the one, about to deliver Israel. And it is now the third day since it happened, but now some of our women have completely confused us. Early this morning they were at the tomb and couldn't find his body. They came back with the story that they'd seen a vision of angels who had said he was alive. Some of our friends went off to the tomb to check and found it empty, just as the woman had said, but they didn't see Jesus." Then he said to them, "So thick-headed, so slow-hearted, why can't you simply believe all that the prophet said? Don't you see these things had to happen, that the Messiah had to suffer and only then enter into his glory?" Then he started at the beginning with the books of Moses and went on through all the prophets, pointing out everything in the scriptures that referred to him. They came to the edge of the village where they were headed. He acted as if he was going on, but they pressed him, "Stay and have supper with us. It's nearly evening. The day is done." So he went in with them, and here is what happened. He sat down at the table with them. Taking the bread, he blessed and broke and gave it to them. At that moment, open-eyed, wide-eyed, they recognized him, and then he disappeared. Back and forth they talked. "Didn't we feel on fire as he conversed with us on the road, as he opened up the scriptures for us?" They didn't waste a minute. They were up on their way back to Jerusalem. This week, I had one of my most frustrating and difficult days. I couldn't get some of the IT work done. I was grumpy and wanted things to go back to normal. I know one or two of you might have struggled in the same way this week or over different things. The two disciples, Cleopas and the second disciple, traditionally called Alpheus, were traveling home after the Passover holiday. Things had definitely not worked out as they had hoped and wished for. They were feeling down and discouraged, and then this fellow comes and walks alongside them. They'd put all their faith in the carpenter from Nazareth, the teacher, leader, and friend. But as we know, things had gone horribly wrong over that Passover weekend, and he'd died a terrible death on a cross. Now nothing seemed to make sense to them, and they were broken and discouraged. The only thing they thought they should do was to go home. Some years ago, I read of a meeting between an RAF pilot, Wing Commander Paul Gerard, and a 65-year-old man named Jim O'Neill. This is the story. Mr. O'Neill suddenly went blind while he was flying his plane at 5,500 feet. A plane was scrambled from the RAF base at Linton-on-Ouse, I think it's pronounced, in North Yorkshire to help the stricken pilot. He was flying a two-seater Cessna aircraft from Glasgow Prestwick Airport to Colchester, Essex, when he suffered a stroke and lost his sight. So the RAF plane flew alongside Mr. O'Neill and the pilot shepherded him to the base with instructions over the radio. Wing Commander Paul Gerard, chief flying instructor, flew his Tucano T1 about 50 metres next to the Cessna to bring Mr. O'Neill safely down. He used his voice to guide him down by telling him to turn left or to turn right, to lower the plane and to do his pre-landing checkups. He did make a rather bumpy landing, but a safe one, and then was rushed to hospital. It's a fantastic story and has a parallel in the story of the two on the Emmaus Road. Jesus comes alongside them, listens to them, guides them. He finds out where they are and then takes things on from there. Even as they talk, before they recognize who he is, he helps them to make sense of things and the way things have unfolded. Notice that Jesus listens to where they are first and then takes things from there. He helps them to make sense of what they're struggling with. It's interesting that in the same way God starts where we are and helps us to find our way through difficult and challenging situations. Someone once put it like this: God draws the starting line where we are. He starts where we are and helps us to make sense of things, if we are prepared, of course, to enjoy his company and listen. Notice also he doesn't force himself upon them. When they reach the turnoff to Emmaus, the stranger doesn't invite himself in for dinner. Cleopas and Alpheus are enjoying his company, and they invite him to stay with them. Jesus won't force himself on us either. Remember the story of the prodigal son, whose dad stands waiting for him to come home, to come to his senses, and to come to where he is loved. The choice is always ours. We can invite God to stay with us, to continue with us, to come into our homes, into our lockdown, and into the things we're about, or we can choose to leave things. It is only when they ask him to stay, that he goes in for the meal with them, that they ultimately recognize who he is. And when he's no longer with them, they discuss how their hearts were strangely warmed and their spirits lifted. Wasn't it like a fire burning in us when he talked to us on the road? Blaise Pascal, the French mathematician, physicist, and philosopher, had a similar experience. Shortly after his death, Blaise Pascal died in 1662, at the age of 39. A servant was sorting through Pascal's clothes, and he noticed something sewn into a coat that Pascal had worn. Out of curiosity, the servant cut out the parchment and read what was inside on the old faded bit of paper. This is what he read: "The year of grace, 1654, Monday, 23rd of November, from about 10:30 in the evening until about 12:30. The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob, not of the philosophers and intellectuals. Certitude, feeling, joy, peace. The God of Jesus Christ, my God and your God. Your God will be my God. Forgetfulness of the world and of everything except God. One finds oneself only by way of the directions taught in the gospel. The grandeur of the human soul. O just Father, the world has not known you, but I have known you. Joy, 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 tears of joy." Notice also what a change comes over those depressed, downhearted, tired followers of Jesus. It's like the Irish when they take a wicket or win a cricket match, with apologies to the Irish. They cannot contain their excitement or stop talking. They are re-energized. They walk or run the 7 miles back to Jerusalem to tell the others what had happened to them. More than half a marathon in a day. May we also have that re-energizing as we trust in God to be with us. Now let us pray. Lord Jesus, thank you that down through the ages you have come alongside ordinary people in their need. Thank you that you continue to walk with us, support us, carry us, and hold us when we find ourselves struggling and trying to make sense of things. Help us to recognize your presence, to enjoy the peace and solace you bring. Help us to work through our frustrations, anxieties, fears, and isolation, and recognize the hope you bring. May our hearts burn with the warmth of your presence. Walk with us and help us to make sense of our lives. Hold us so that we can face the new day and the weeks ahead with you. Amen. What I'd like to do now is to show a video of a very well-known song, one that the teachers don't particularly like normally, but I know many of the students like, and it's very appropriate in terms of what I've been saying, but also of where we are at the moment.
One more step along the wild I go, one more step along the wild I go, from the old things to the new, just keep me traveling along with you. Round the corners of the wild I turn, more and more about the wild I like, and that new things that I see. You'll be looking at along with me, and it's from the old I travel to the new. Just keep me traveling along with you. Give me courage when the world's rough. Keep me loving though this world is tough. Deep and singing all I do, just keep me traveling along with you. And it's from the old I travel to the new, just keep me traveling along with you. Than the world can be. You are younger than the life in me, ever old and ever new. Just keep me traveling along with you, and it's from the old I travel to the new. Just keep me traveling along with you.
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all this day and forevermore. Amen. God bless you all.